just a request of dua for our Mawlana Samahat al-Sayyid Rafiq Naqawi and other people who are sick in the community. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give them the fastest recovery. So please, we will recite Amma Yujib for all mu'mineen who are sick. May Allah give them the fastest recovery. So together, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ووصينا الإنسان بوالديه إحسانا حملته أمه كرها ووضعته كرها وحمله وفصاله 30 شهرا حتى إذا بلغ أشده وبلغ 40 سنة قال رب أوزعني أن أشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علي وعلى والدي وأن أعمل صالحا ترضاه وأصلحني في ذريتي إني تبت إليك وإني من المسلمين صدق الله العلي العظيم. My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. First of all, I would like to congratulate the Muslim Ummah for the arrival, birthday occasion of Fatima al-Zahra, Salamullahi alayha. And particularly the Muslims of this country, and especially those of us who are in this masjid, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to be the true followers of Zahra alayha salam. Because of this happy occasion, I wanted to touch about the importance of mothers, or what we call it Mother's Day, because her birthday is Mother's Day. So we wanted to talk about the importance of mothers in Islam. And how does Islam look at the mothers in general? This ayah that I just read is mentioned in Surah Al-Ahqaf, in ayah 15, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. You know, in life, there are two types of things. There are certain things you don't need to be mentioned about. They are so easy that everybody can remember. Like, you don't need to mention to somebody, 1 + 1 = 2. It's easy. Everybody knows this. You don't need to tell somebody that fire burns. You get closer, it burns you. You know that. It's easy things. Common sense. But there are certain things, because of their importance, despite the fact that it's common sense, but Allah comes to talk about it and even mention about it over and over because it's very important. Just to make sure that, as a human being, you don't forget the importance of those things. One of those common things that we don't need to be reminded over and over is that by nature, we know that we have to appreciate anybody who's kind to you. You walk to a place you want to enter, somebody opens the door, you say, thank you. You want to lift something, somebody gives you a hand, you say, thank you. Now, you don't need to think about, oh, should I thank him or I shouldn't. Or somebody doesn't need to tell you to thank the person to thank them because it's a common sense. Now, you put this into one perspective. You come to our parents, our mother. Somebody opened the door, we say you thank them, right? Now, the mother, how much she have given to us and our parents in general? A lot of giving. They have given a lot of things they have put in our lives. For that matter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, as many ayahs in the Quran, Allah said, وَوَصَيْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. Allah said, we, and you know, why would Allah in the Quran say we? Allah is one or two? It's one, right? We say, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. But here said, وَوَصَيْنَا, we, Allah, have advised. Allah, are you one or two? We is for plural, and you're one. Why are you using the word we? Here in Arabic and some other languages also, we have these similarities. And that is, if a person is a higher person, respected person, when they talk, they don't address themselves as I. They address themselves as what? As we. Even though they want. How? Because they are very respected. And even sometimes we, when we address someone, even though it might be a one person, but we say what? We say you in the form of plural. And guess what? Even Allah does to some of his servants too. If a person is a very devoted, dedicated servant to Allah, Allah doesn't use the word you singular to him. He uses we to him, or you plural for him. Example, Imam Ali alayhi salam. You look in the Quran, Allah was so amazed about one of the actions of Imam Ali. When he was to describe him, he didn't say he. No, he said they, in the form of plural. Where? إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ plural. الصَّلَاةِ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ plural. وَهُمْ رَاقِعُونَ. Allah is referring Imam Ali. He was a single. He was the only one who did this. But Allah referred him to what? To the plural, because he is a high respected one in the sight of Allah. So any person who is high respected in the sight of Allah, Allah also used the same thing as he used for himself. So here when Allah said, وَوَصَيْنَا, we, Allah, have advised. Advise whom? Sometimes Allah advises mu'mineen. Sometimes he advises good Muslims. But here Allah says, my advice is to the general humanity. Which means, respecting mothers and parents, it has nothing to do with being a Muslim or non-Muslim. It's something that is by nature you have to respect parents. That's why Allah says, al-insan means a human. And you know, in the Quran, there is three names Allah used for human beings. And each one of them, when Allah used them, there is a reason. For example, the first name is the word insan. And insan, it means human. But the word was driven from one of the quality of humans, which is forgetfulness. See, one of our natures, we forget. From the word nisyan. Since we forget, in Arabic, this word was driven from nisyan, they form insan, meaning the one who forgets a lot. That's the word insan. So when somebody's calling you insan, that's what it means. The one who forgets a lot. And you know, don't take it negative. No, forgetting is a ni'mah. It's a good thing that Allah makes you not to forget. So thank Allah for you to forget, because otherwise your life and my life would have been miserable. But because we forget, is another ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us. That is one of the name is used in the Quran. Name number two is called Bani Adam, the children of Adam. Name number three al-bashar, humans, right? But you know what is a beautiful? Anytime Allah wants to talk something very, very positive about human being, He used the word Bani Adam. You know why? Because Allah ascribed us to our father Adam. Out of respect for Adam, when he wants to talk something positive, Allah said, Bani Adam, the children of Adam. Then he ascribed us to Adam, alayhi salam. But if you want to talk something negative, you know the word he used? Al-Insan. Negative, any negative you see Allah talk about a human being, then the word that he called is what? Al-Insan. Ya ayyuha al-Insan, ma gharraka bi rabbika al-Kareem. Oh, you human, what caused you to be arrogant in front of your Lord? Number two, inna al-insana ladhalumun kafar. Human being is most, it's one of the creatures that is so dhalum, so unjust and ungrateful. So anytime Allah will talk about something negative, He used the word insan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is the same, because we forget to do a to appreciate these blessings of parents. That's why Allah used, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. Allah said, we advise human in general, male and female, all on the same level, to respect their parents. Be kind to their parents. See, up to here, Allah is talking about mother and father. Right? Now, as soon as he finished there, then Allah leaves the father behind, and then now it's about mother. What happened? He says, حَمَلَتُ أُمُّهُ. The mother carries him. وَقُرْهَنْ كُرْهُ mean on difficulty. The carry that you carry, a mother carries the baby, she carries him based on difficulty. And I always say this, brothers, you want to try it? This is for brothers. Just try putting a backpack on your tummy. 24 hours. You go sleep with it, you take a shower with it, you do everything with that backpack on your tummy and see how it feels. And just for 3 months, not 9 months, just 3 months. That is what the mothers have to go through. But this is all, no, this is even just the beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهَا. She carries him on difficulty. What are some of the difficulty? Here are some tips, brothers and sisters. Number one. You know, every one of us, we have favorite foods, don't we? Sometimes we like certain food, we like certain drinks. But a mother, as soon as she becomes pregnant, they tell us, you can't eat this food anymore. Why? I love it, my favorite. No, because of that baby. No, I'm good, but the baby is not good. So I'm going to stop that favorite food of mine. Allahu Akbar. 1 day, 2 days, no, 9 months. Not only that, that is one of the what Allah said, Qurha, one of the difficulties. Moreover, one of the difficulties is get to the point. No place is comfortable for her to sleep. Back is not comfortable. Sides is not comfortable. And moreover, brother, even sitting is not comfortable. All this she goes through because of what? Because of you and I. Allah said, حَمَلَتْهُ كُرْهًا وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. And Allah said, وَحَمْلُهُ, that pregnancy, وَفِصَالُهُ, and the period of breastfeeding, Allah said, both in together, ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا, 30 months. She have to deal with one child. And if she and all she is not lucky, and they become twins, Allahu Akbar. That she has to do even twice of more. Now this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, she has to deal with this for how many months? For 30 months. And this is one of the ayahs that our scholars, starting with Imam Ali alayhi salam, prove that a woman can be pregnant for the period of 6 months and the child can survive. And you know, there are some prophets who were born for 6 months, right? Prophet Yahya alayhi salam was a 6 months born baby. Imam Hussein alayhi salam was one of them too. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that 30 months a mother have to deal with this over and over. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Hatta idha balagha ashudda. Allah said, until you become stronger, you become mature. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa balagha arba'ina sana. And you reach at the age of 40. Hey brothers, you know what? The age of 40 is a very dangerous age, right? Very, very dangerous. It's very good age, but it's dangerous for some. How? See, at the day, from the day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started the creation of human being, as you're going up until you hit 40, from 40, now you're coming down. Not going up anymore. And if you are lucky, and at the age of 40, you are on the right path, then you're on the track. But God forbid if a person is 40 or over 40 and still have some problem. You know what Shaitan says? Shaitan, huh? As soon as you hit 40 and you and I are not on the track, Shaitan says, welcome to the club. Because you cannot make it out of that club anymore. That is why the Prophet, even our Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala waited until Prophet reached to the age of 40, then Allah told him, now start your mission. Because 40 years is like the cruise level in your life. If a person at that age, he is on the right path, then he can continue on that path. But if not, it's very tough. That is why they say, any bad habit that you have, make sure that you get rid of it before you reach 40. Because as soon as you reach the age of 40, it becomes harder than ever before to overcome those bad habits. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً. Allah says, when you reach at that age, 40 years old, Allah says, remember your parents. قال, say, رَبِّ أَوْزِعْنِي. Say, oh Allah, make me be among those who always remember to be grateful for your blessings. أن أشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت وعلى والدي. And also be grateful on my parents for the blessing you have given them to raise me as a Muslim, to raise me as a child, and give me those principles in life. Allah says, وأن أعمل صالحا ترضى. See, five things in that ayah you're asking Allah, or you should ask Allah. The first one is, you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you be the one who is always grateful to Allah. That is number one. Number two, also to bless your parents as well. That's two. Number three, also to help you to always do the good deeds that He will be pleased. That is number three. Number four, Ya Allah also, Ya Allah, protect my family, my children. Number five, Ya Allah, help me to be a one who repent and return to you all the time. That is the dua Allah is telling you and I to say when we reach to that age. That is the importance of parents, brothers. Where? In the Quran. Now let me take you to the hadith. You know, in Islam, the importance of parents is this point that some hadith the Prophet mentioned. That if a person is in the state of salat, you know, when we stand in front of Allah and you say Allahu Akbar, everything becomes haram. Everything except the acts of salat. You want to talk to somebody, it's haram. That's what we call takbirat al-haram. Means Allahu Akbar, that makes everything haram in your life. Now, why everything is haram? Because now Allah said, I want your attention just to me and nobody else. That is what it is, right? Now look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as you are in the middle of talking to me, right, in the namaz, in the salah, you say, Malik yawmiddin, iyyaka na'bud. And the mother calls you. In salat al-nafila though, but not wajib. Nafila. If a mother calls, Allah said, I allow you to pause my communication and listen to your mother. Allahu Akbar. You know how mothers are important? I'm doing my salat, Allah is speaking to you. Nobody is above you, Ya Allah. Allah said, yes, I know. But your mother also is important. I allow you to pause your salat and talk to her. More than that, brothers and sisters, I want to fast on Thursdays. Mustahab fasting. A mother said, no, I don't want you to fast. Can I skip that fast? Allah said, yes, you skip that. Okay, Allah, I wonder, oh, the ajr. Allah said, listen to your mother, we give you that ajr, even though you don't fast anymore. What about the credit of that fasting? Allah said, don't go ahead, don't fast, but we will give you the reward of fasting. Why? Because you listen to mother. A man came to the Prophet, Ya Rasulallah, I want to go to jihad. I want so bad to be with you in the battlefield. But I have one obstacle. What is your obstacle? I have a mother. The Prophet says, do you have anybody who can take care of her? He said, no, Ya Rasulullah. It's just me. The Prophet said, go and sit home. Take care of her. And taking care of her for every minute you spend with her is better than you going and dying in the battlefield 70 times. Time you spend with the mother, taking care of the Prophet, your reward in the sight of Allah, is better than somebody who becomes shaheed in the battlefield with the Prophet. A man came one time, he was carrying his mother on his head, doing tawaf. After he finished tawaf, he went to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, this is my mother. I've been taking care of her all this time. Ya Rasulullah, have I done enough? You know what the Prophet told him? He said, Wallah, Wallah, walaw bizafratin wahida. He said, not even an inch of what she has done for you. Nothing. You haven't done nothing compared to what she has done. A man came to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, who should I be obedient to? Who should I be kind and nice to? The Prophet told her mother. Who else? Your mother. Who else? Your mother. Who else? Your father. Who else? Nobody else. Mothers three times, father one time. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran and the Prophet. Now you come, one of the examples of those mothers is Zahra alayhi salam. If you want to see a woman who has materialized the motherhood in her life, in every aspect, it's Zahra as-salamullah. By the way, you know what they say? The qualities of mother. Because when you say mother, it's not just giving birth to a child. That's not a mother. Everybody can do that. But when you say mother, they say a woman who carries three qualities. Number one, they say a woman who has unconditional love for her children. That is number one. Number two, unconditional care for her children. That is two. Number three, unconditional protection for her children. There's three qualities. Any woman who has this is called a mother. And you know, Zahra, salamullah, she's one of the examples. That not only she takes care of her children, even she went beyond that to be a one who takes care of her a father, alayhi salam, the Prophet. That she's known as Ummu Abiha, mother of her father. That is Zahra alayhi salam. Zahra alayhi salam, when she was born, there is no time to get how she was born, how this, but when she was born, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam gave her so many names. But you know what, brothers? Wallah, it's amazing. Every name of Fatima Zahra is one of her attributes. Without comparison, you know Allah's 99 attributes, right? Every attribute of Allah prescribe or describe one of Allah's attributes, right? Zahra also, every name of her, it describes one of her qualities. Now let me share with some of those names. Number one, she is called Tahira. Means what? Purified. Right? Pure one. How is she pure? Now listen to the Quran. Allah says, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ طَاهِرًا وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. And she is one of those who were purified. That is number one. Number two, one of her name we call her what? مَرْضِيَّة. The one who is pleased by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know what the hadith says about her from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What does the Prophet say? The Prophet said, Ya Fatima, inna Allah la yarda li ridak. That Allah is pleased when you, Fatima, is pleased. So when she's called Mardiya, don't think that is just name. Like you and I, sometimes when we name our children or ourselves, we're trying to emulate those names. No, Zahra, she materialized those names. She is the one that describes that name in her nature, in her life, in every part of her life. More than that, Zahra, salamullah alayha, one of her name we call Ma'suma. Infallible. You think maybe she tried to become pure one, infallible, or she is infallible. Fatima Zahra, she is one of the infallibles. That in her khutbah, which unfortunately we don't get to talk about her khutbah so much. Well, I think it's very, very important. When someday we get a chance, every one of us, please take a time and read her khutbah and see what she says in that khutbah. Because in that khutbah, you know, Usul al-Din is in there. Furu al-Din is in there. And not only that, she goes to tell you everything we do in Islam. What is the aim? What is the reason? What is the wisdom? Every detail is in that khutbah. In that khutbah, you know what she said? She tells us that she is infallible. What does she say? She says, Wallahi ma aqulu ma aqulu ghalata wa la af'alu ma af'alu shatata. Whatever I say, I don't say wrong. And my actions are not wrong either. Meaning, I am infallible. That is Zahra alayhi salam. So when here they say, Ma'asuma, don't think that she's trying to become infallible. No, she is one. Whatever names you see about Fatima alayhi salam, she materialized those names, brothers and sisters. Now, not only that, brothers and sisters, you know Zahra alayhi salam, she is the center of everything in the sight of Allah. Center. And when you say center means what? That the heart of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. You know, when you grab heart of something, you get it, right? Now, the heart of Ahlul Bayt is Zahra alayhi salam. And this is not my words. This is Allah's word. You read Hadith al-Kisa, right, brothers and sisters? Pay attention careful when we read those things, right? Now, listen when Jibreel asked Allah, Ya Allah, وَمَنْ هُمْ تَحْتَ الْكِسَى Jibreel is asking Allah, Ya Allah, who are those under that blanket? Under that blanket, you know there are five people, right? The first one is Rasulullah, the second one is Imam Ali, then Fatima, then Hassan, then Hussein, right? Now, between you and I, if you want to start between these five, who would you start? You always start with the Prophet, right? But Allah didn't start with that. What did he say? When he said, Ya Allah, women whom tahta al-kisa, who are those under that cover? The answer came from Allah, Hum Fatima wa abuha wa ba'luha wa banuha. Ya Allah, Allah started with Zahra alayhi salam. You want to know who they are? The first one underneath Ya Allah, Allah mentioned is Zahra, and then from her he goes to her father, and from her father he goes to Imam Ali, and then he goes to her children. Because she is the center. And this is not just by words that Allah said, even practical, that is what the Prophet did too on the day of Mubahala. When the Prophet ﷺ was taking the children and the family to go and do the curse with the Najran, those Christians who came, how did the Prophet put them together? Read in the history. The Prophet ﷺ was carrying Imam Hussein on the heart, on his chest like this. And every one of them described something. You know, when the Prophet carries Imam Hussein here, when Imam Hussein at the age that he can walk, this is to tell us something. The Prophet doesn't do anything unless there is a wisdom. The Prophet was carrying Imam Hussein on the chest here. This is to indicate that you, a mu'min, always keep Imam Hussein in your heart. Then he had Imam Hassan on the right side, holding his hand. What does it mean? That if you want to know your right path after Rasulullah, this is one of the examples, Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Then after the Prophet, there was whom? There is Zahra alayhi salam. Then after Zahra, there is Imam Ali alayhi salam. Now, why is she between Imam Ali and the Prophet? Why? That centralized that Zahra alayhi salam, she is the center in the sight of Allah and Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. That is Zahra alayhi salam. Brothers, I just want us to take some lesson from Zahra tonight. Both of us, brothers and sisters. Lesson number one that I want us to take from Zahra tonight, because when we talk about Zahra and Ahlul Bayt, it's not about we come here about them and that's it. No, let's learn something and emulate their life and practice what they say and what they do. Number one, let's all learn the lesson of giving from Zahra. Giving. See, that we have the lesson of giving, and we have the lesson of giving the best of what you have. Zahra, she is the second one, not the first. See, we all give, right? Now, if you want to donate to Salvation Army, what do you give? Things they don't want, right? Old clothes, old shoes, things that you are not wearing, the ones that you are now don't want to wear them, you are ready to get rid of them. Say, okay, yeah, you can give it to them. Meanwhile, yeah, you do deserve this one. I deserve the nice one is still for me. That is us. But you know, Zahra alayhi salam, one of the lessons we can learn from her is what? It's always when you want to give something, it doesn't matter whatever it is, give the best of what you have. When I say gift, not just money, brothers, no. I mean everything. And let me come here and say, even sometimes you want to volunteer for something, right? You want to give your time. Unfortunately, we want to give our time, but we give the worst of what we have. What is it? Today I don't feel like going, so I'm not going to go. It's volunteer anyway. Or I go as late as I want because it's volunteer. I'm not getting paid, so I can go anytime I want, right? So who cares? If they want to fire me, so be it. Right, but if I'm my job, I get paid. I get there on time, make sure that I clock in, I finish on time because I get paid. But volunteer, who cares? No, that is not the right message of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Anything you want to give, give the best of what you have. And that is from Zahra alayhi salam. And Allah also stated that. Allah said in the Quran, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. Allah said, you expect good from me? You're not going to get good from me unless you give the best of what you have. You want an example of that? In Surah Al-A'raf, Allah talks about two children of Adam alayhi salam. They both give sacrifice, but Qabil gave the worst of what he had. Habil gave the best. You know, you think Allah is dumb, right? Sometimes we think that Allah doesn't get it. He takes anything. So we good ones for us and then the bad one for Allah, right? Qabil was thinking that way. Allah said, فَتُقُبِّلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمَا وَلَمْ يُتَقَبَّلْ مِنَ الْآخَرِ. Allah said, I accepted from Habil because he gave the best of what he had. And I rejected Qabil because he gave the worst of what he had and kept the nicest for him. Zahra alayhi salam is one of the examples of giving. And not just giving, giving the best of what she had. That the narration say one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked Zahra, where's your wedding gown that I bought it for you? Fatima to Zahra say, Ya Rasulullah, I give it away. What do you mean you give it away, Zahra? That's something that's special in your life. You should keep it. You know, Ya Rasulullah. A man came asking, somebody came asking, I didn't have something to give her, and I looked, the best of what I have is my wedding dress. And I wanted to give it. Allahu Akbar. And not just the Fatima, Ahlul Bayt in general, brothers. When they give the best of what they have. Now go to Surah Al-Dahr. When they fasted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about them. He said, وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ. They love the food, right? Sometimes when you want to make nazar, when we cook our home, not all of us, inshallah, when we cook our home, mashallah, the chicken, the fish, that is for home. Nazar, doesn't matter, anything can go. Now here, Allah SWT said, Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, when they gave the best food, they love, ala hubbihi, they love the food, but they give it away. And one more lesson. Sometimes when we give something right, we have expectation. He didn't even say thank you to me. He doesn't even say salam to me. He doesn't even bow down to me. I made his life this way. I did this. But Allah said to us, Ahlul Bayt, when they give, you know what they say? La nuridu minkum jaza'an wala shukura. We expect no thanks. We expect nothing from you except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know Imam Hussein, what he said in one of the hadiths? Imam Hussein said, two things always forget and remember two things. Two things, always keep in mind, never forget them. And two, always forget them. Number one is forget any good deed that you have done for somebody. But never, ever forget bad things that you have done for somebody, to somebody. You did good to somebody, I say, always wipe it in your mind. But you did wrong someone, I say, always keep in mind, never take it away. The other two is never ever remember any good things you have done for Allah or for the sake of Allah. But always remember any sin you have done between you and Allah. These two things, I say, keep the two and forget the two. But unfortunately, we reverse it, right? If I do something good for somebody, mashallah, 100 years is always there. As soon as I see the past, you see this shirt? I give him that shirt. The shoe is worn, I bought it for him. Right? Now I have to embarrass him to everybody to know that I did it. Right? Allah said in the Quran, La nuridu minkum jaza'an wala shukura. That is lesson number one from Zahra. Lesson number two, brothers and sisters, is the lesson, this from the sisters, for sisters, that Zahra was known as one of the best speakers, which unfortunately we don't have among our sisters today. We need sisters who can stand in front of the podium and speak powerful like Zahra, salamullah alayhi. Defend the usul al-deen like Zahra did. When Imama was breaking at that time, Zahra, salamullah alayhi, she was not quiet. Yeah, she was at home when everything was right. But when things went wrong, she went out and she sat on the minbar and she gave that khutbah which shook the entire Medina. That is one lesson, sisters. We need to do that. Unfortunately, we don't pay attention to that part. We don't have more speakers from the sister side. We need to learn from Zahra alayhi salam. Dedicate your time. Learn how to speak. Walk out. Speak out. And stand against injustice like Zahra did. And this is not just for sisters, it's for all of us. When she saw that one of the Usuluddin was being harmed, she wasn't quiet. She went to the masjid and she was in her hijab, and she sat on the podium, and she gave that khutbah, starting from the life of the people before Islam, till after that, and the reasoning and wisdom, unbelievable in that khutbah. That is one of the lessons we need to learn, brothers and sisters. How to speak, vote our opinions, tell the truth, stand against the injustice, no matter which form or which color. It doesn't matter where it comes from and who it comes from. That is lesson number two. Lesson number three from Zahra alayhi salam is to learn to be friends to Quran. You know, one of the things we ignore, brothers and sisters, is Quran. Zahra, salamullah alayha, she was always a friend of Quran. Today, mashallah, we are friends is iPads and cell phones. And Quran, our relationship with it is like once a year, right? And you know, 1 month in a year, and that is the month of Ramadan. Ramadan comes, mashallah, we go and, oh, my Quran, why did I leave my Quran? Now I have to think, because it has been so long. Since I saw Quran, now Ramadan comes, I go, oh, it's dusty, wipe it off, mashallah, a'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim, until the night of Eid, inshallah, sadaqallah al-azim, inshallah, we see you next year if we're still alive. Allahu Akbar, brothers. That's your constitution from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I always say, brothers and sisters, if we are to treat our Quran, the Quran, just the same we treat our cell phones. I'm not asking you more than that. No. The way you treat your cell phone, just treat Quran in the same level. Wallahi, we will be the best Muslims on the planet. When you and I go out and you forget your cell phone, do you come back for it or not? How many of us? You left home. You forgot your cell phone. You are miles outside. Oh, my God. Then you have to make a U-turn. It doesn't matter where you're going because cell phone is at home. I can't survive without it. You will come home to pick that cell phone. Do we ever did that with the Quran? If we are to treat the Quran the same as these cell phones, Allah will be better Muslims. How many times you and I, you open your cell phone and say, oh, this message, I get text message. Okay, you read it, and then you text back, right? Maybe more than some of us handle text messages, receiving. Sometimes we drive, we text, right? Now, Quran is a text message of Allah. Text it to you. How many times did you ever open that text to read it? Your cell phone that you carry, always when it started ringing, you want to look and answer. You're driving, you're sleeping, you're picking up the call. Okay, hello, hello. You want to receive the call. Now, how many calls in the Quran? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, Quran, a call from Allah. Well, we don't even care that Allah is calling you. And you know what is sad? The call that you receive on the cell phone, at the end of the year, the month, you have to pay the Verizon, right? But this is free of charge, but you still don't want to listen to it. The texting that you text, you know, somebody that you read your text, at the end of the month, you have to send a check to them, right? But Allah sent you free text. But you don't want to read it. How many years, brother, every birthday of our children, what do? We buy them cell phones, we buy them clothes. How many of us ever give Quran as a gift to our children on the birthday? Sending the message that you need to read this Quran. This is the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many of us ever did that, brothers and sisters? We buy them iPod, laptop, everything. I'm not saying it's haram. It's good to buy them. But when you buy them, these things, did you ever keep in mind that they need, along with these things, they need the Quran too? This is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the message from Zahra alayhi salam. She always was friend of Quran. On top of that, brothers and sisters, Zahra alayhi salam was example in every aspect of life. A mother, a wife, a friend, and everything. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to emulate his steps, ya Rabbal Alamin. Ya Allah, we ask you day in and day out, help us to learn and live the life of Zahra alayhi salam. Ya Allah, help us to carry the message of Zahra alayhi salam in our lives, ya Rabbal Alamin. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Question and answer. Inshallah. We go to the dua, inshallah. Oh, there's one. Okay, yes. Yes. The first thing, the two things that you should forget is that when you are kind to someone, that is one thing that you should forget. And the second one, you should forget also, whenever you are able to do something good for the sake of Allah, like Salat al-Layl, you give somebody sadaqah, you did something good, always keep it out of mind. For human being or for Allah. And then also the other tool is that if you wrong somebody, always make sure that you don't forget that. Or if you sin, never forget that. Always keep that in mind. Yes, sister.
I have a question.
Yes, yes.
If somebody has a problem with another religion, should we send it to the mosque? Should we send it to just a little bit that we know? And then you share some information. You send a person to the mosque, and you tell them the way that they have a problem with the church or brother.
Yes, the question is, okay, if somebody has a question about religion, let's say a Christian or Jewish, they want to know more about Islam. The sister is asking, should we send the person to the masjid where they can get the answer, or we should answer them what we know? The answer is that it depends on the person and you, the person. If you know that the question of that person is something you can answer, then yes, of course, you don't have to send them to the masjid. You take care of it then. It's like if somebody is sick and you know they need CPR, and you know how to do CPR, do you call somebody or you take care of it yourself? You take care of it then. But if you don't know how to do it, then you have to show them where to get the help from. So it depends on the situation. If you can help them, then that's what should be done. If you cannot, then send them to where they can get help, and so they can be helped where they will get that help. It's Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein. But hadith doesn't matter. You know, they're all from one light. So if you say Imam Hassan or Imam Jafar, they're all from one light. But this one is probably from Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Yes. 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 After you cut your prayer, yes, then you start again. Yes. Because after the salat is being stopped, when you come back, you start again. But it depends. Like if I'm praying, let's say, for example, series of salat. Let's say, for example, salat al-layl. I'm in the third two rak'ah. Like I pray two first rak'ah, two second rak'ah. Now I'm in the third one. Now when I come, I'm not going to start from the beginning. No, I'm just going to continue from that two rak'ah, which will be the third one, and then the fourth one, and continue. Yes. That's right. Yes. Okay, I think we end this with the dua. So we go to dua al-fa'l. Yes, please. Yes. Oh, okay. It's a good question. I think sister is asking for the brothers now. The question is, we mentioned that if a child is in the prayer, in the nafila prayer, but please keep in mind, not wajib salat. Wajib salat cannot be stopped for anybody. It's mustahab salat where Islam allows us to do for mothers. Now the question is that, are we allowed to do the same thing, like when I'm in the state of salat and my father calls, can I also cut my prayer to attend to my father? The answer is yes, you can. Yes, you can. I'm sorry? Inshallah. Now you go to dua al-faraj together. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma kun li waliyika حجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.